Hello, Rahul Riji Nair. Welcome to Film Companion South.
Thank you.
I'm very puzzled to be doing this interview with you right now because I know you as this wonderful indie film director. And the first film you showed me was Ottamuri Velicham, which was your first film, feature film as well.
Yeah.
I missed your second film, but then I saw Kallanottam, which is again wonderful. And congratulations on winning the National Award for Best Malayalam Film this year, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
And then suddenly I'm interviewing you for a movie called Coco. What just happened here? You know, it's like...
two different films, in two different zones.
Two different Rahul Riji Nairs, right?
Now my second film, again, no, you haven't watched it, but right. It was again a full-on commercial.
It was? Okay.
It was a no-brainer comedy, actually.
Okay.
It just follows stories is what... comes naturally to me. I try and go after stories that kind of I want to make films out of. So it kind of happened in a way that one became an indie, the other became a commercial. There was no planning as such.
Okay.
It just happened on an organic way.
Right. No, that's interesting because usually people define themselves as like independent filmmakers or mainstream filmmakers because in their head they say, I want to, appeal to a large audience or I want to, I don't want to make the movie exactly that I want to make. You're saying you're able to split your brain both ways.
It started off from my early influences probably. The most commonly watched films in my lifetime would be from Priyadarshan sir or Satyendrikan sir and Srinivasan sir. So I grew up consuming those kind of films and those are really very special to me from those Malayalam films from the 80s and 90s.
Right.
So that actually made me fall in love with cinema. And it was only at a very later stage that I discovered this whole world cinema
right. And
this film festival and this. Then I, all of a sudden it came to me, okay, there is this stream of cinema as well, which was not probably something I grew up to. Only after I started learning filmmaking in a way that I... as a pursuit to be a filmmaker, I started going for film festivals. IFFK was a real opener for me, eye-opener for me in that sense.
Yeah,
and
yeah. That's
when I realized, okay, there are like Latin American films with which I can fall in love with or Iranian films that I crave for. So that's something that slowly started in me. And so I probably got the best of both worlds, I suppose.
That's wonderful. Do you find that though... you're saying that, okay, you're making Ottamuri Velicham, you're making Kallanottam, you're making Coco, which is a sports drama, underdog sports drama, which is one of the most exhausted genres in the world, right? It's like this about this Coco teacher who comes to physical education teacher who comes to a school with a lot of socially deprived children. Mm. Now, when you're doing a movie like this, does your mind, that's what I was asking, does your mind automatically take a different direction saying, okay, now I'm mainstream Rahul Riji Nair? You know, that's what I'm trying to ask because, you know, when you're making Kallanottam, I'm seeing a very, very different, of course, you showed me Coco, so I know the movie now.
Yeah.
I'm seeing a very different filmmaker, whereas I'm seeing the beats here are commercial film beats.
Yeah, yeah.
So, do you find that, that's what I'm saying. Do you say, I'm not going to be
actually,
that person?
No, actually not.
Okay.
Because when I start with a film, when I first wanted to be a filmmaker, like everyone does, I also wanted to do the big mainstream commercial cinema. And
right.
I went pitching to actors, production houses and getting rejected every day. So, it kind of sinks. It stuck me that, okay, this probably I need to kind of figure out what my first film is.
Great,
and
okay.
Make that first film that I want. And that's how Ottamuri Velicham happened.
Okay.
And then once Ottamuri Velicham got that kind of, it won the Kerala State Award and got recognized at film festivals.
Right.
It was in Mami as well, they were remade for the first time. So at that point, then I started getting opportunities to make those bigger scripts that I wrote before.
Yeah.
So then at that point for me, I don't think it from, okay, this is for commercial or this is for the film festivals. What excites me is that story idea that I'm trying to narrate. For me, what changes between these two films is their business. Except for the business part, like when you have a star in a film, it obviously gets marketed in a very big way. It has the kind, you have the kind of publicity marketing budgets for it.
And right.
It gets sold. It has new revenue streams that indie films does not even have. So that kind of business part, there's always a huge difference. But for me as a filmmaker, I try and go with utmost sincerity with the story.
Right.
I'm not really bothered if it is mainstream or if no. it's...
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. Like, okay, you have Rajisha Vijayan as the heroine.
Yeah.
Did you write it saying that I want a slightly big name heroine in this role?
No, not really.
Okay.
This script was written 2.5 years ago.
Okay.
And it got selected at Film Bazaar.
Okay.
At the co-production market. So again, Film Bazaar co-production market is for more indie content.
You mean Coco, right?
Yeah, Coco.
Yeah.
So it got selected there. So at that point, I was trying to figure out, I would probably, even if it was not for Rajisha, the budgets would have definitely changed. But then with even an actor, I would probably made the same film is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
Because for me, as you said, a sports drama genre is something that's always has a mold. I don't claim that I've broken the mold, but I kind of make sure that my mold is a little different.
Right.
So in that sense, like in the film, if there's a relationship between the teacher and the student, for me to come to Coco, that was the most exciting part of it. So,
okay.
That is from these moments that I realized, I want to narrate the story. And,
right.
And I'm not very genre conscious in that sense because it's a selfish interest probably that I want to make as many different genre films.
No, 100%. No. See, the genre film itself is not a problem. Yeah. But, you know, with a sports drama, underdog sports drama, one has to be especially careful, right?
Yeah.
Because, like, it's one of the earliest Hollywood genres.
Correct.
Like, in India, we've done, quite a few of them. You know, like there's one, you know, the David Goliath story, yeah. whatever. Here, I mean, you do your own things. But what I'm saying is, I think it's interesting to see you follow, like, I see in a good way, I don't mean this in a bad way, yeah. but I see a slightly less subtle Rahul Ruchi Nair in Coco than I do in Kalanottam or in Ottumari Vedicham.
Yeah.
Like there are some things that you explain a little more, mm-hmm. that maybe in those movies you might have not explained so much, you know,
correct.
Which is not a bad thing. I mean, because you are
making for a mainstream audience.
Audience. So those things you do, like it comes.
I haven't done it purposefully.
Okay.
I haven't done it at all purposefully. I just went with the followed the story.
Story, okay.
For Kalanottam, as you said, there was no point in explaining because the cinema lies only what the camera sees.
Yeah.
And we do not want to explain what happens behind
right.
the camera,
right.
what the person is thinking or all that is, we have just cut it out.
Okay.
Even if the film's tail end, you know, as you know, we do not explain anything
of what happens after it. Yeah.
So for that story, I felt that kind of a treatment was
better,
doing more justice to it.
Right.
But when I tried to narrate the story of a teenage girl and a teacher, this is what comes to me. I never wrote the script to kind of, okay, suit a mainstream actor or
right.
I never had this thought of, okay, even if it's going to be out in a festival, because the first things, a few of my film festival curators who when I announced this film, they were the first ones to watch this film.
Right.
And they were asking me to submit it to film festivals because since we have this release date very soon, we couldn't do it.
Yeah.
So I never had that kind of a distinction. I just honestly want to try and do justice to what I had in mind.
No, this is the best thing really because, you know, I think it's amazing that I think I differ with you because I do think that these movies, so I think it's amazing that you say this because I think it comes very unself-consciously to you.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there are a lot of people who can only think in a mainstream way. Yeah. There are a lot of people who can only think in an indie way. You know, this ability to do both according to the screenplay, I think it's a rare gift.
I probably do not know if it's a rare gift or few of my friends who are in the mainstream film industry, they say my films are too art house. And the people in the academy section of filmmaking or from the independent zone, they say your films are made too mainstream. So I do not know where.
Yeah, no. So this whole conversation is not to say you are indie or you are mainstream.
Yeah,
not for that.
Yeah.
But just to see how you handle.
I just followed the screenplay.
Yeah.
This when I'm Fortunately, I wrote the four scripts that I've made into films right now. So all those four scripts, however they organically developed to me in my mind, I've tried to
do that.
And it's vice versa also, because in when we were making Ottumari Velicham, that was my debut film, and while we were shooting it, we had no clue whether we will even get this film out to an audience, because you know the struggle of an indie filmmaker get into a good film festival, to get by recognized by curators that. So we had no clue about it. So once I finished the film and I was started showing it to a few people who might like it or who might recommend me or help the film travel. So their first feedback was, this has three songs and there's a lot of background score. So this does not fit that stereotypical art house film. Yeah. So I didn't make any change to it. I that's how I conceived that film. Even before it was getting selected somewhere, before the New York premiere all happened, I was getting this feedback, you need to cut out this song from here because people at film festivals do not like hearing songs. I don't agree to it at some point, at levels, and I thought, okay, this is the film that I made. I tried to be at most sincere to it. I kind of give my 100 and not just 100, I don't know, I give my life to it. Yeah. I give my life to all those films that I make, because I do not know if I get to make another film tomorrow. I do not know how many films I will get to make tomorrow. Right. So probably for me, the film that I'm doing right now, I probably dedicate my life to it. So I have done that justice for all my four films, and then I see, okay, if I don't know what the fate of the film is. Sometimes it might get rejected, it get accepted, but whatever it is, I am happy with the way that my films are, because I'm 100% content of, okay, this is what I wanted to do with the stories, and I've done justice to it. So that's my
takeaway. That's your contentment.
Yeah.
So when somebody like Radisha comes in and says, okay, I'll do your story, then it becomes better because you're able to take your story to a bigger audience.
Correct, correct. Absolutely.
Right.
That trust also comes inherently, because these three films my company has produced. So Ottumari Velicham, Kallanottam, and now Coco. So Dagini was different, a bigger banner, management banner produced it. But when I do these films, that first question is, can't you take it to another banner or bigger banner? So I'm very skeptical, because I do not know to convince people of, okay, how can I convince a person about a film that happens only what the camera sees? So that kind of an idea, it's very difficult for me to narrate and convince unless and until it gets accepted or recognized. It is very difficult to kind of make the film that you want. So for me, that comes from that point of zone where it is not just about me, it's a whole group of people who are behind me, because if it was not for them, these films would not happen. Because you know that these films do not come from the point of, oh, we'll make money, we'll get some money out of it. Because when we make Ottumari Velicham, Kallanottam, we are only going by our creative desire. We are not targeting any financial or monetary benefit from it. So it is a whole group of people, all the technicians who work with me, they are backing this vision, they are buying into it. It is that trust that actually translates. So for us, it's from that zone that we are seeing those films.
Now, Rahul, you are a marketing person / engineer, computing person and all that, and then you came into films. So I'm going to use you for some time as a teacher, because there are some people who are going to be watching this interview who want to give up what they're doing and begin to make films. So I want to ask you, first of all, at what point did you say, I can't do this anymore?
I don't know. It came from as I said, I was trying to pitch this big commercial cinema to all many actors.
This was even while you were in your other jobs?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was,
so you always wanted to become a filmmaker?
Not from my childhood. Also, I made a documentary in 2011. And after that, documentary got well received and all that, I kind of took interest to filmmaking and cinema as a medium that I want to pursue.
Right.
Then I never had any filmmaking background, or I never assisted anyone. So YouTube was my film school.
Right.
So to kind of get my hands-on filming, I started making small short films. And it kind of is a pitching video also. I started making the small short films, and that's from where I started learning the techniques of filmmaking, about lensing, about editing, about music, and all that things that I started learning from short films. But even at the time, I was writing my own scripts and pitching it to production houses and actors. And then it was, there was point when there, I don't want to explain these struggles because this is very generic. Every filmmaker has this.
No. There's a generic struggle, but what I'm saying is, but something in you said, I can't do this anymore. I need to follow. So I'm trying to get that point because everybody worries about, you know, money, salary, this, that, all that kind of stuff. So at what point did you say, I just cannot do this anymore?
So I had this opportunity to make the big commercial cinema one at real close by. And after like working for it for almost a year, that got dropped off in a, like a flash of a second, it got dropped off. So that actually triggered me to rethink what I was doing because I felt, okay, I worked my heart out and still I'm not able to get there. So that is kind of a very, that rejection, that failure kind of gave me a huge setback in life. So I then started thinking, is this really what I want to do? Because I was really being pushed to the wall at that point. And still, if I wanted to do, wanted to make a cinema, I thought, okay, I need to do something really big now. So I was, until that point in time, I was also having that luxury of a 5-digit salary and all the other comfort. So I, okay, probably now I need to put my 100% time into this. And earlier, I was probably putting 50% of it. So that failure actually
helped you.
Kind of pushed me hard because by that failure, I should have either stopped this and just focused on what I was doing, or I should just give up everything and go the other side. I chose to give up.
Yeah.
So that was the point where I started, okay, this is
what you want to do.
This is what I do.
Yeah. No, so that's one thing, right? The other thing I'm really curious about with filmmakers is it's different. It's like you can say, I want to be a filmmaker. This is my dream. I want to be a filmmaker. But there is a certain skill in translating the image in your head to, I mean, I'm leaving scripting and all aside, but I'm talking about a pure director. There's a script, there's an image in your head, you want it that way. Only few people are able to get that image onto the screen because only they know. Basically, I'm talking about, at what point did you know that, I know I want to do this, but now I know I can do this.
When I started making short films.
With the YouTube short films.
Yeah, the YouTube short films. That gave me a lot of confidence. And some of those short films just have 5,000 views or 7,000 views. I mean, it was that success of it and all that was not...
Yeah, it was a practice field.
It was like, for me, that was a huge motivation in there. Okay, I can do this now. So, and by that time...
Can you explain that motivation as in?
Like, once you see that coming out... once you see, even if it's for 2 minutes you're narrating, or 5 minutes you're trying to narrate.
You're saying, I was able to put that story in my head on screen.
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Once you actually see that translate, and then you kind of have this whole group developing. We were all like, we have DOP, the editor, actors. We were all like trying to figure out whether this is what we wanted to do at this point. And this whole group was coming together.
Yeah.
That's how this First Print Studios was kind of born. I'm just the nominal head of that production company, but there's a lot of people behind it. So that's when we realized, okay, we want to make our cinema, and there was this huge mutual trust among us.
Nice.
And that trust actually started translating. And that's when I said to everyone, okay, for Temuri Velicham, we made that film in a very small budget.
Yeah.
And that was the only money we could afford at that point. So once we had that script, we knew that this script could be made in that budget. We did not go otherwise. We did not see how much money I have, and we did not try and make a script for that. We had a script in hand which we all love to see as a film. And that film, we knew that we could achieve it in the zone.
Yeah.
And then we actually worked on it and kind of started working on it and then pulled it off. But even at that point, as I said, we never knew whether this film will even come out.
Yeah.
So we thought probably it will end up in our TV screens where we will actually watch it and feel good about it.
Yeah. But Rahul, is there a difference? Okay, I make a documentary. I know I can make a good documentary. I make a bunch of short films on YouTube. So I know that I can make short films that work on YouTube. Is there a difference between that and making a feature film? Or is it the same headspace and the same skills that you use to make a film as well?
In that, from the creative perspective, I think there is not much difference because we're approaching the same things.
Right.
We're working with the same people.
Yeah.
But on the other side, there's a huge pressure when you're making a feature film.
Business marketing.
Pressure,
okay.
Yeah. Especially when we are making an indie film, because there is no revenue source that you can readily tap into.
Yeah.
So we are borrowing money from everywhere, and that pressure is always there.
Right.
And we are working on that resource crunch, kind of pushes us a little bit more, and the stress levels go high. Because we probably want to shoot this in automobilism, there's that big landslide, that climax that we were shooting.
Yeah, yeah.
And we had only money to shoot it in 2 days. So we are thinking, okay, how can we shoot it in 2 days? We did a lot of pre-work, but still on the ground, that's a challenging sequence to work with.
Yeah,
that's a lot of VFX and all that. So for us, that pressure is always there.
Yeah.
And in that high intensity pressure, your decision making actually changes. So that is where probably I feel some of the films does not really translate into what we really want it to be. That with every feature film, I believe that even if it's for a commercial, that the business part of it, the money part of it is huge.
Right.
So that pressure actually, after all, this direction is about decision making.
Yeah.
And when you are so into that pressure zone, then that decision making kind of gets affected. So this I started learning in the first few days of Automobilism. I started shooting it. It was all going right, but I was so stressed out that I was like, what is the next thing that I was to shoot? Because while I'm seeing my actor perform this, I'm thinking about how to set up my next scene. So because of that,
time is so limited.
So after the first few days, I realized, okay, this is not the way I wanted to work. This is something that I really wanted to fall in love with. But now it was like I'm just trying to do an assignment or something.
Nice.
So that's where I took a pause and I said, okay, see, come what may, I'll do it at my pace and I'll do it at the way I want it to be. So after the 3-4 days, our work pattern itself started changing. We started enjoying more. We started having more fun on the sets. And the other first 4 days, we were like working on a corporate company. We were like, we have this scene shot in this half an hour time period. At the time, we were lighting up another scene in the other room.
Yeah.
So we stopped doing it at that some after 3 or 4 days because we all realized that, okay, we are not kind of enjoying this as we wanted to.
Yeah.
So that after that first few days, it kind of took off.
Yeah. And I'm glad you say that because what you're basically saying is, when you're making a film for YouTube and with just a bunch of people and for passion, you have all the time in the world.
Correct.
And you can kind of, you can take hours to set up a shot,
correct.
Tomorrow you can say, no, that shot didn't work, I'll do this or whatever
and
it is.
Most often it will not have much of resources also.
Yeah.
It's your friend's camera or your lighting setup will, probably your LED light will come from a friend. So we are all doing such small work.
Right.
So, but when you're with a unit, now there's a lot of other people involved in that filmmaking process. And there are a lot of labor, daily wage workers. So every single day of cost now gets doubled up if you fail to do it. But then at that point, if that stress kind of gets to you, I feel that decision making kind of gets changed and that alters what your filmmaking vision, what you really set out to be.
Okay. So Rahul, you made Coco now and you're going to release it. How do you make sure, of course, Rajisha Vijayan is there, so she's a popular face now, she's going to help sell it a bit. But there is also this constant clutter, right? Let's say your next movie, you don't have a star because you're saying you follow the script, right? How does one cut through the clutter and let people know that such a movie exists? Because reviews alone are not enough, right? Because if there are 10 movies, then there are 10 reviews. People cannot see 10 movies at the same time. How do you cut through the clutter and say, okay, this movie is worth watching? Like, how do you make sure that communication goes through?
If you're asking from an indie film standpoint, so the first thing that we decided when we started making Automobilism was we are not going to do a theatrical release because we know the challenges behind it. And even for Kallanottam, we knew that we are not going to have a theatrical. So we 4 years ago, I am probably in a very... kind of a very fortunate space, I would say, compared to my seniors or the generation before, because now I have the OTT platforms to take my films to.
Yeah.
But still, as you know, it is very difficult. Even OTT platforms want a star or a non-face, but still when a film like Automobilism got recognized, we had a direct OTT release.
Yeah.
So for me, that business part of it, I keep it very separate from the filmmaking process.
Okay. Are you good at that?
I'm learning at it probably. Okay. Because it's more of survival now.
Yeah, so, but don't you have to have both brains, right? Like a creative brain and a business brain.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry, you have to have three brains: an indie brain, a commercial brain, and a business brain.
This business part of it, we are on the run, on the job training is what we are probably getting, because
right.
there are certain films that we want for Coco. When the idea was to be shot it during just after the lockdown.
Yeah.
But we were very sure that we wanted it to be in theaters. We shot it in a canvas that was bigger.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
That film was designed for theaters itself. So
yeah.
in that in terms of its ambience, where the locations where we shot that film and all that. So that was there. So this business part of it, actually only after the film is done and all the work on it is done, I start thinking about it. So fortunately, when we were making Coco, that noise was cut out because no films were releasing.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
There was a lot of uncertainty of all this COVID situation.
Right.
So we made the film that we actually loved and
that you wanted to make exactly
the way we want. And that comes from your actors and your technicians actually trusting what we want.
Yeah.
So even I do not know if I'm going to. So also in filmmaking, as a director, I feel there are a lot of things that you need to fall in place in terms of budgets and actors' dates and all that. Coco was not the film that I was supposed to be doing as my fourth. It was a bigger commercial film than Coco. Then all of this restrictions came in, and then this is what we'll do
now.
So I just do not know. I don't have a plan set and my next film is going to be a smaller one or bigger one. But I just have a set of stories that I am very passionately following through. So I just want to see them made into films. So that's my only drive, I feel. So
wonderful. You have a set of stories.
And probably the ones
you have a bank.
Probably three or four more, which will probably go on increasing. But
yeah, no, but it's wonderful because, you know, it's like you're a young filmmaker. You've gotten noticed in festivals. Now you have this big commercial film coming out. You're able to kind of, you know, balance both. And I think that's quite a rare thing. I'm going to conclude this by asking you one question, which I always like to ask filmmakers. Does being a director require a certain instinct? Like, are you born with that instinct is what I want to ask you. Because, you know, there are some things called there are some things that you find some people, for example, being a great chef, right? They have it in them. I think they have it in their DNA, because I don't think however much you train, if you don't have that, there's certain something in your DNA that skill is not going to come to you. Do you think direction is like that, or can it just be you can go to school even if you don't have it and then develop it as a craft?
I don't know. I can answer it for myself. I'm a very impulsive person.
Right.
I'm very driven by instincts and I'm very impulsive. I do not know when I made a big commercial film like Dagni and when I announced Kalanottam, a lot of my people who are on the outside who are well-wishers and friends and all that, they actually message me, you shouldn't be making this film because you might end your career here, because there's a set track that you need to take once you've made a commercial film and all that. And after Kalanottam, when I announced Coco, I again get similar feedback. You should do a mainstream hero kind of a film now, because your last three films had women-centric stories. So I do not know if I follow them. I do not have a plan as such. So I feel that risk-taking is something that I have in me. And it has always been there. So being a very naughty child to growing up to be a filmmaker, it's always been there. So that's kind of is, I feel that instinct. See, when a film like Kallanottam gets recognized at a national award, I'm getting that validation to trust that instinct.
That's exactly
more.
It.
Yeah.
Right.
Because otherwise that film would have been forgotten. Only when such filmmaking attempts get recognized, I as a filmmaker, I do not know how the change in the world, how it perceives me. I do not know what change it makes to them.
Right.
But for me as a filmmaker, what really changes is that belief. Okay, this is what you are doing the right thing.
I'm saying that belief. Is that belief an inborn thing, or can one acquire that belief as well?
I think it can be acquired.
You can?
Because it comes from the point of like hard work and passion and commitment.
Okay.
Because I put my life into all my films. I virtually have my life on the line. I feel like my life is on the line for every film, because I do not know what happens next.
Right.
I do not know what film I am going to do next, whether I will even get a date of a star, whether I will get to make, even if it's a small film, I do not know if whether I will get to make it.
Yeah.
So every film for me is like, probably this will, I do not know, this will probably be my last film. So I have to give it my everything. And so when I start that filmmaking journey, it's quite tough to be, my family knows probably, or my close circle of friends know that. But for me, it's that complete surrender comes out for that medium, for that passion.
Okay.
And it is from that surrender, I feel, that belief comes in. It is not just, okay, I don't know, there's this hard work always beats talent, I feel. So once you are putting your life into it and you don't have two ways about it, then I think that belief will automatically pick up.
Wonderful, Rahul. Thank you so much. I really, you know, I've enjoyed your films, and I think you're a very, very promising filmmaker. And I look forward to more than those four films or five films that you have in the bank. Hopefully you have many more, and all the best. All the best for Coco.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for having me here. It's all, I just told it to my friends and family that the Bharadwaj Rangani is interviewing.
Oh, no, it's just kind of a, yeah, no, but it's seriously, it's great, because, you know, I think like people like you who are kind of thinning the line between the two kinds of cinema, which is like instead of saying totally art house or totally you know, commercial, but trying to find a nice middle ground of both.
I think I'm like this kid in the toy store, and I, whatever I fancy, I just go behind it.
Fantastic.
I don't know.
I hope you always do that, Rahul.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hi, I am Rahul Ruzi Nair. If you like this video, please subscribe to Film Companion South. Thank you.